Hi everyone, welcome back to the lecture on pediatric endodontics. We have already seen two lectures, part 1 and part 2. We will quickly recapitulate. Part 1 was when we looked at the pulp tissues between permanent and primary, the differences in variation. We also looked at deep caries management. In part 2, we looked at the procedure of pulpotomy and procedure of pulpectomy. Okay, so this is the concluding part and part 3. So in this part, we are going to look at three more procedures, which is apexogenesis, apexification, and regenerative endodontics. Okay, so let's begin with a case-based discussion. As you see on your screen, that a 13-year-old boy reports to you with the chief complaint of severe nocturnal pain. Nocturnal pain means pain, especially during sleep, in the lower right back region of the mouth since 3 days. And on examination, you find that tooth number 4-5, that is your second premolar, mandibular right second premolar, has got an IC dash score of 0-5, that means extensive caries. And if I were to ask you, what is your provisional diagnosis? Okay, so you will ask me for a radiograph, right? So here is a radiograph. Okay, let me get the pointer going. Okay, so this is the tooth of interest. We have a deep caries lesion, and you can see the pulp is involved. And we also see what? We also see that the roots are not completely formed. The roots have not matured. The apex is open. So what would be your provisional diagnosis for tooth number 4-5 based on the history, the severe nocturnal pain? Then how will you manage this particular tooth, and what are the clinical challenges in restoring this particular tooth? Okay, so the provisional diagnosis is acute symptomatic irreversible pulpitis because of the nocturnal pain, and the clinical management would be to do a root canal treatment. Okay, in the root canal treatment, clinical challenge is obturating the tooth which has an open apex. So that would be a challenge for us. Okay, now let's look at another scenario. Okay, here we have a 10-year-old patient who reports with a history of traumatic injury to the upper front tooth 1 hour ago, and the tooth 1-1 and 2-1 have complicated crown fracture, that means pulpal involvement. And what would be the clinical challenges in restoring these teeth? So here are the two teeth with coronal fracture involving the pulp. Again, you see that the apex are quite wide open. Okay, the roots are not mature. So we will have a clinical challenge of providing treatment for these situations where there is an open apex. Okay, so what we now understand is a situation where we have a open apex and a closed apex. Some of the features of the open apex is that the walls are very thin. If you can see here, the root walls are very, very thin. Okay, and in closed apex, the root walls are thicker, and this produces a challenge for us where not only we have to deal with an open apex, we also have to deal with the fragility of the thin root thickness. Alright, so here we have two scenarios we can have. We can have a vital pulp or with an irreversible pulpitis. Example in this case, where there may be a trauma, so where the pulp is still vital and no open apex. Or we can have a situation where there is a deep caries lesion and the coronal pulp and the radicular pulp have all undergone necrosis. And you can see in this particular case, there is periapical lesion as well. Okay. And in this particular case, you can see an open apex. So we can have a situation where you have a non-vital pulp with an open apex and we have a vital pulp with an open apex. So try to remember this, because the clinical management of these two scenarios will be different. Okay, now type of open apexes, there are two types, blunderbuss and non-blunderbuss. The blunderbuss is the gun which had such a wide opening and hence the name blunderbuss. So this blunderbuss gun opening resembles the tooth here. So this is a blunderbuss opening. So normally teeth where the root formation is still in the initial stages, you will have blunderbuss. Where teeth which are in the molar stage of 8, 9, they will have just the root length is formed, only the apexes have not closed yet. So they are called as non-blunderbuss. Okay, so these are some differences for you to read. So this brings us to the first clinical procedure that we can perform, which is apexogenesis. Now, very important, apexogenesis by definition is a vital pulp therapy. That means a pulp has to be vital of an immature tooth, which means which has an open apex that permits continued physiological root formation, root maturation and apical closure. That means root formation, physiological root formation, that means the length increases. Root maturation means the thickness of the root increases and ultimately the apex closure takes place. So remember, in this particular case, it is a vital pulp therapy. That means the radicular pulp has to be vital. So the indication, like I just told you, the radicular pulp has to be healthy. So what are the signs of healthy radicular pulp? There is no spontaneous pain. There is no chances of irreversible pulpitis. Tooth which is non-tender, no swelling, no mobility, indicating that periodontal ligaments are healthy, the bone surrounding the tooth is healthy, normal presence of the periodontal attachments, that means the periodontal ligament spaces are normal, lamina dura is still intact, the pulp is exposed during caries removal or recent trauma. So if you see here is, in cases where there is a recent trauma, you can do apexogenesis, or iatrogenic pulp exposure, you can do apexogenesis. Then the tissue appears vital, that means the radicular tissue appears vital and you are able to control hemorrhage. So here in all this particular case, you can do apexogenesis. Now apexogenesis is done only for permanent tooth. Apexogenesis is not done for primary teeth. Okay. So what, how many types of apexogenesis? So apexogenesis, like we discussed, it is an end product where we see the root physiological root formation, root maturation, apex closure. So it is an outcome. So how do you achieve this outcome? We can do three procedures to achieve this outcome. And these three procedures will preserve the vitality of the radicular pulp. Okay, for example, let's take cervix or partial pulpotomy. So here, like we discussed in the last lecture, only 2 mm of the exposed pulp is excised and then MTA is placed and the tooth is restored back. So here in this particular case, we just do cervix pulpotomy, that means widen the pulp exposure, remove 2 mm of the exposed pulp, place MTA and then restore the tooth with GIC as a base and composite as your final restoration. So this is cervix pulpotomy. So what it will do is it will preserve the vitality of the remaining coronal pulp and therefore remaining radicular pulp, and therefore the vital radicular pulp will help in the physiological root formation, root maturation and apex closure. Now in this particular case, that is the direct pulp capping, the exposed pulp is dressed with a medicament. Again, you can go for MTA or you can go for biodentin. So here during iatrogenic procedure, you accidentally expose the pulp, the exposure is surrounded by sound dentin, then you can go for a direct pulp capping. So in this case also, you're preserving the radicular pulp by preserving the coronal pulp and the root formation can complete. Or you can do a coronal or a conventional or a complete pulpotomy, where the coronal pulp is surgically excised and the radicular pulp is treated with a medicament and then the radicular pulp is left to heal. Okay, so from the last lecture, we have discussed pulpotomy, where you can use hard setting calcium hydroxide, MTA and biodentin to as your regenerative category of pulpotomy. Okay. So we can do apexogenesis, we can achieve apexogenesis, okay, by either of these three procedures depending on the clinical scenario. So just quick recap. So if you have a traumatic exposure of the pulp, only 2 mm or less, Or you can have an iatrogenic exposure, or if you are going to have exposure which is more than 2 millimeters and exposure which is surrounded by caries dentine, in that particular case you can remove the caries dentine and do a conventional pulpotomy. So this apexogenesis is only for permanent teeth, not for primary teeth. Okay, right, so here in this case, if I were to give you a radiograph like this and if I asked you identify what treatment has been done, you should be able to identify. Okay, so first radiograph will give you some clues, like there is a coronal fracture, pulp exposure here, the apex is open. This is from the case 2, so we already know the case history, and in this particular case the exposed pulp has been treated, and in this particular case you see the root length has already grown in length and thickness and apex closure. So this is a case of apexogenesis has been achieved, which could have been either with cervix pulpotomy or with direct pulp capping or with complete pulpotomy. So either of the three. Now, what happens when you have an immature tooth with a non-vital pulp? Okay, the immature tooth with a necrotic pulp and apical periodontitis in this figure, okay, represents a multiple challenges to successful treatment. The infected root canal space cannot be disinfected with a standard root canal protocol with aggressive use of endodontic files, because the files can further weaken the narrow or thin root walls. Okay, and once the microbial phase of the treatment is complete, filling of the root canal is difficult because open apex provides no barrier for stopping the root filling material from impinging on the periodontal tissue. So if you want to put your gutta percha, the gutta percha will go through and through into the periapical area. So we do not have any barrier. Otherwise, the apical constriction in a fully formed root, that means if you see here, you will have an apical constriction which will form a natural barrier for the gutta percha. And third one, even when the challenges described earlier are overcome, the roots of these teeth are thin with high susceptibility of fracture, right? So you see thinness, if another trauma comes to the tooth is going to fracture away. So for non-vital tooth, these are the clinical challenges that we face. So how do we go about it? So what we do is something called as apexification. So apexification by definition is a method of induction of an apical calcific barrier in a necrotic immature permanent tooth where the root development is ceased due to pulp necrosis. That means the physiologic root development cannot happen anymore because the pulp has died already. The pulp has become necrotic already. So in this particular case, we use something called as apexification. So what we do, the mechanism of action apexification is that the Hertwig's root sheath retains the capacity to function after an interruption in the normal apical development. So there may be some Hertwig's root sheath still remaining in the apical papilla of an immature root, which we can use to form that calcific barrier. So let's see how. So this calcific barrier, if you see in the radiograph here, is quite evident. Is we have a case here, open apex, and this is a calcific barrier here that we have introduced. Okay, so this calcific barrier in this particular case is an MTA. So we have placed an MTA here, and this MTA will set and harden, and then we will have a barrier. So now we can put gutta percha against this MTA and obturate the canal, just like you see in this picture here. So you have an MTA plug, and then we have a root filling, that is a gutta percha, and then you have your post endo GIC or composite, and then bonded resin. So this is how it's a typical MTA apexification. Now if you do not want to do MTA apexification, what you need to do is you need can also do calcium hydroxide apexification. Okay, so for now just remember MTA apexification and calcium hydroxide apexification are two ways of inducing a calcific barrier. Now calcium hydroxide technique is done, and again we follow the same protocol, case selection, local anesthesia, rubber dam, then we remove all the necrotic pulp from the root canals gently and determine the working length, and through chemomechanical debridement. Remember we discussed chemomechanical debridement in pulpectomy, where our objective is to remove all the necrotic tissue and have chemical disinfection of the canals. Okay, so we're not doing cleaning and shaping, so we are doing chemomechanical debridement, and then we place a suitable medicament and close the access cavity. and then we allow the tooth to heal. When the tooth is free of signs and symptoms, that means your draining sinus or draining fistula has closed, which is a sign of healing. The canal is medicated with a non-setting calcium hydroxide paste and a permanent restoration is sealed. So the whole root canal in the second appointment is opened up. Again, chemomechanical debridement is done and then calcium, non-setting calcium hydroxide is filled into the canal and overfilled to push some calcium hydroxide into the periapical area so that the calcium hydroxide will instigate formation of osteoblast like cells, odontoblast like cells, cementoblast like cells. So remember, we are talking about permanent teeth here. So permanent teeth are programmed for blastic activity, that means formation. So we try to overfill it. Then due to this overfilling, the osteoblast like cells, the cementoblast like cells, the odontoblast like cells, they will form, and then they will form a physiologic barrier. Okay, so in calcium hydroxide, in MTA, the placement of an MTA plug caused us to have a barrier, but in calcium hydroxide we are hoping for the body to react and form a calcific barrier. So it normally takes about 2 years for that calcific barrier to happen. So the patient has to come at interval of every 3 months for us to see whether the calcific barrier has been formed or not. So every 3 months that he comes, we do take a radiograph and we assess for radiographic appearance of the calcific barrier. And every 6 months, we open up the cavity and with a blunt end of the gutta percha, we try to feel for the calcific barrier, which may not appear radiographically, but which may be present clinically. All right, so this is a case here. This is a tooth here. It's already discolored, okay, indicative of pulpal necrosis. So this is the tooth here. That is here is how we are checking for the root length. This is the gutta percha, the blunt end of the gutta percha. This is the calcicure, non-setting calcium hydroxide that is used. And this is an example. This is how if you fill the calcium hydroxide into the canal, it will appear like this. Okay. And then later when you want to check for the apical formation, this is the blunt end or the bigger end of the gutta percha and gently feel for the apical end, for the apical closure. So there are five outcomes of the apexification as given by Frank, who introduced the procedure. One is no apparent closure but a resistance point when file is inserted. So clinically there is an apical closure but radiographically it is not there. The second possibility is radiographic evidence of calcific barrier at the apex. So you take a radiograph and then there is a barrier. Third is apical closure without canal space closure. So here you see there will be apical closure, okay, but the canal themselves have not closed, and then you can also have a normal continued apical closure, okay, or you can have increased radiographic evidence of resolution of apical pathology. Okay, so for the MTA technique where we introduce the apical barrier, okay, how did it come about? So calcium hydroxide required, apexification with calcium hydroxide required a very long treatment time, okay, and this was always a problem because patient would tend to forget after first or two, one or two visits, they tend to forget to come back, and the long duration makes it difficult to follow up, and because of the thin root canals, the tooth were prone to fracture, and calcium hydroxide would also make the remaining root canals thickness of the root fragile, so it also is prone to fracture. To overcome this, the alternative was to use an artificial apical barrier which allows immediate obturation of the canal. So this is where the MTA came into picture. So the introduction of MTA in 1993 actually was used for repair of perforation during root canal treatment, and then later we realized that this can also be used for apexification. Okay, so the material is mixed with sterile water, the ratio of 3:1, which results in hydration, that is pH is 12.5, that is very high pH, leading to a set in approximately 2 to 3 hours. So the cement sets in 2 to 3 hours. So it's good for us. So as soon as it sets, we can obturate the canal, and the high pH will also instigate the remaining tissues in the apical papilla to form calcific barrier itself. So sometimes you see the root formation continues and the apical MTA plug is also there. So this is pictures to show you how the MTA plug is done. So the tooth is there, this is the working length done here, then we place the medicament to disinfect the root canals. After the medicament is placed, the root canal is disinfected, the apical plug is there now here. Then the root canal is filled with your gutta percha, only gutta percha, and then the tooth is restored back with post endodontic restoration and probably a crown. So this is MTA barrier technique, MTA apexification technique. So the last technique that we are going to discuss is the regenerative endodontics. Regenerative endodontics overcomes the difficulties or the clinical challenges of apexification. So regenerative endodontics is done in scenarios in teeth which have non-vital pulp and which are immature. And again, this is done only for permanent, not for primary. So in this particular case, what regenerative endodontics does is it overcomes the clinical challenges of apexification, which are that the root length never forms, physiological root length never forms. The thickness of the remaining root structure is very thin. It never thickens, and therefore it is the whole tooth root is prone to fracture. And because the root length has not grown, the crown to root ratio may be poor. So regenerative endodontics, what it does, it tries to overcome this by continued formation of root canals. How does it do that without a healthy pulp? So what they do is they use these stem cells in the periapical area, okay, and we irritate that stem cells or the apical papilla and cause bleeding. And when the bleeding enters the canal, all the stem cells that are there in the canals in the blood, they react with the, let me give you a pointer, yeah. So they react with the dentine and they form odontoblast-like cells, cementoblast-like cells, and these cells can instigate the growth of the remaining root structure. Okay, so here the blood flows in the canal in form of a clot, and then on the clot you have to place an MTA to seal the clot, and then a permanent restoration, and then we put the tooth under observation. So in this particular diagrammatic representation, this is how it will appear. The pulp will regenerate. Okay, it may not be the original pulp, but the stem cells will cause a pulp-like tissue to form, and this pulp-like tissue will cause the root formation to continue and root apex closure to be obtained. Okay, so now here in this particular radiographic series, you will see that this is the particular tool we are looking at. Then this is the access cavity preparation has been done, the clot has been introduced, and the apical, not apical, the MTA plug has been placed, and this is the observation as 12 months follow-up. You see the root thickness has increased, the root thickness has increased, and the root length has also increased, and this is a follow-up after 2 years where you see the MTA plug is there, and below the MTA plug is your calcific barrier formation, and below that is your root canal formation. So this is a successful regenerative endodontics. The problem with regenerative endodontics is that it's unpredictable, and therefore there are no 100% guarantee for success. Okay, so if regenerative endodontics fails, we have to go back to apexification. Right, now let's test your understanding through a case. Below is a radiograph of a child aged 10 years who has sustained a fracture involving pulp, reporting to you after 2 weeks of injury. Presently, the tooth is symptomatic, indicating irreversible pulpitis. What would be your treatment plan? So if I give you this radiograph and this case scenario, what would you do? Okay, the first thing you have to look at the pulpal status. The pulpal status is indicative of irreversible pulpitis. That means we have to remove the pulp, then only the pain will go away. So once we remove the pulp, there is no pulp tissue, and then how is this open apex going to close? Therefore, our treatment option is either apexification or regenerative endodontics. All right. In this particular scenario, identify the treatment performed for the deep caries permanent molars. So this is the deep caries permanent molars. Can you identify the treatment? So what you have to look at is your the coronal portion. So I see a stainless steel crown and I see a radio opacity in only the pulp chamber. Okay. And then I see open root apex. Then in the next radiograph, I see the open root apex is now closing and it has closed completely. So most likely this is a case of apexogenesis through complete pulpotomy, right? So the coronal pulp has been removed and the radicular pulp has been preserved. So this is a case of apexogenesis using complete pulpotomy. All right, so this brings us to the end of the session. Spend 5 minutes to recapitulate and write down the keywords from this presentation and reach out to me for any queries or questions on the e-portal, or you can find me in the clinics and we can discuss your queries face to face. Remember, what we have learned today is we have learned 3 treatment procedures indicated only for permanent tooth. None of this is for the primary tooth. So apexification, apexogenesis and regenerative are not to be done for primary tooth. So take home message. Remember this. I will test you in your MCQs on this. All right. Okay. So that's it from me. Thank you for listening to the presentation. And if you have any queries, feel free to reach out to me. Okay, bye-bye.